Last week, an Oregon man filed a federal lawsuit against the government for a 2012 police brutality incident that left him in the need of back surgery. According to the plaintiff, Jermaine Robinson, he was biking near his home when two cops pulled him over for bike violations and then proceeded to throw him off the bike, beat and taser him. Now, Robinson, who's an African-American, is also requesting that the city police department institutes a new policy against racial profiling. And rightfully so, because racial profiling when it comes to policing is hardly confined to Oregon. According to the National Criminal Justice Reference Service, 25% of police officers have witnessed fellow officers harassing a citizen, most likely because of their race. 52% agree that it's not unusual for a police officer to turn a blind eye to improper conduct by other officers. And 49% feel that the only way a criminal would receive punishment was to punish the individual himself. So here to discuss the institutional reasons behind these statistics, as well as his new film on police brutality called Black and Blue, I'm joined now by filmmaker Dylan Avery. Thank you so much for coming on. Dylan,
hey, Annie, good to see you, man.
So before we get into your latest work, you made the film Loose Change. It's probably the most viral online documentary ever made. I mean, how did that insane experience change you as a person and a filmmaker?
Drastically and unexpectedly. You know, it's funny that I'm here in D.C. 10 years after I was living here finalizing Loose Change, and I really had no way of anticipating how big it was going to be, how drastically it was going to change my life, how many people would reach out to me, and just how much was going to happen. So insanely change my life.
You know, really briefly, what do you think about kind of the movement being hijacked by kind of this everything is a conspiracy and everything's a false flag now?
You know, that's one of the reasons I had to walk away in about 2006 is when it started. You know, you had the whole no planes at the World Trade Center nonsense and all that. So really, it really kind of came to a head 2006, 2007, and it was over the following couple years where I realized I just, you know, you say that you're for 9/11 truth, and you could mean that you're for a new investigation into the attacks, but then they'll think, you know, whoever you're talking to, like, oh, you think that no planes
so
at the
Sandy
World
Hook didn't happen, right?
You're Sandy Hook didn't happen, and I mean, like, everything's a false flag, you know, everything is a government cover-up. I mean, 24 hours in, before we even have any information, it's automatically being declared as one thing or another. So it's a dangerous situation we find ourselves in.
It is, Dylan. I think we're on the same page in a lot of ways. And I think what people were most upset about, including me, is that you, this political amazing filmmaker, took such a long break from making political commentary. But you're back, baby. You're back. You're making the film about police brutality. What initially made you want to tackle this huge subject?
Well, you know, I'd been somewhat following the issue for a long time. You know, when Oscar Grant happened, I was up at a lot of the protests up in Oakland. But it didn't really start to seem like something that I should pursue or tackle until I moved to Los Angeles. You know, coming from upstate New York, my experiences with the police had generally been pretty positive. And even traveling across the country, you know, there were a couple times where I possibly could have been in trouble and I wasn't. So it was quite a shock to me to move to Los Angeles and, you know, one night I'm walking my dog past midnight and before I know it, I'm being interrogated by a Los Angeles deputy sheriff because I don't have my ID. And I'm like, dude, my house is right there. Like, I can literally walk and get my ID. He's like, no, I'll get into the back of my car and we're gonna get to the bottom of this. So that was a real eye-opener for me. And if it wasn't for the fact that I had my dog with me, I probably would have gotten a little bit more mouthy with him. But I've seen what cops do to dogs.
Right.
And I'm sitting in the back of my cop car and I'm seeing this cop like walk up to my dog and I'm just like, oh, please just don't let anything. And that was a real eye-opener to me because it went from, we no longer see a cop car and feel protected. We feel intimidated. We feel scared. We wonder, you know, am I going to be the next Oscar Grant? Am I going to be the next whoever? You know, choose your example. And that's the thing, is there are so many examples now of injustice and police brutality. And it's not just beatings, you know, it's not just shootings. It's botched investigations. It's money doing all the talking when someone's innocent son is killed by his best friend. Things like that. Like, it's across the board. The whole justice system right now is backwards.
So you're seeing a lot of these systemic kind of institutionalized things as your investigation's unfolding. You've been talking to victims, victims' families across the country. Dylan, another aspect of police brutality is the war machine stockpiling local and state police forces. I mean, according to the Pentagon's own data, since 2006, precincts across the U.S. have been given 432 MRAP machines. I mean, these things are like giant tanks, 533 aircrafts, over 94,000 machine guns, 435 other armored vehicles, whatever that means. I mean, how much do you think the militarization of police has to do with the increased levels of force that we're seeing?
Very much so. They're intrinsically tied. I mean, Fargo, North Dakota has a tank now. And I mean, when I think terrorist attacks, I don't think Fargo, North Dakota. You know, you've got these guys, they're overseas, they're in Afghanistan, they're Iraq, they're in legitimate war zones, and then they come back to America, and then they become police officers. So they spend all day, every day, being shot at, being threatened, fearing for their life, etc. And then they come home, and then they're given a badge and a gun, and they're told to go out into the streets, and they bring that mentality back home with them. So I think that the militarization of the police is a big facet of why we find ourselves faced with the problem that we have now.
Yeah. You know, a few months ago, I spoke to Ray Lewis. He was a police commissioner for Philadelphia, and he became an Occupy activist, actually. And he said that police agencies actually vet candidates who are the most sociopathic and lacking empathy. I mean, it's just amazing to hear this coming from someone as high up as he was. I mean, do you think that there's a systematic effort here from the top down to institutionalize this kind of brutality?
Yeah, absolutely. And there was that headline that was going around a while ago where, you know, someone tried to become a cop and they told them, oh, I'm sorry, your IQ is too high. You know, and that's the thing is, like, what kind of person wants to both follow orders and then enforce the orders that they're given onto other people? Like, it takes a certain, like, I don't see you or me becoming a police officer. I don't see any of these cops getting off the job and going home and playing their guitar. You know, which isn't to say that all cops are bad, which is really the kind of paradigm that I'm trying to make sure I make clear from the start with this is not an anti-police film. It is an anti-police brutality and injustice film. So if you were a good cop, you got nothing to worry about. But if you're a bad cop, then you might wind up in my film.
Why do you think this is, Dylan? Because I feel like compared to other, especially European countries, I guess, America just has such what's become an epidemic now of Absolutely. This brutality. What is it about this country?
I don't know. I think that the past decade, a lot of things in this country have changed. I mean, before September 11th, there was no TSA. There was no Department of Homeland Security. Border Patrol was handled by Border Patrol. Now it's handled by the Department of Homeland Security. You have seen an increase of a war machine that was already there and already existed. I mean, Smedley Butler was, you know, very clear on that. Dwight Eisenhower, you know, warned us about the military-industrial complex, except now that has seeped into our local police departments. So it's really hard to try and point to one particular thing and say this is the cause, and I don't even know if I'm going to be able to do it in the film, but, you know, we have a serious situation on our hands, and I think that there's a lot of facets that play into it.
Yeah, you're right. I think it really is the military mind, children of the empire, having kind of this moral authority to, you know, we're policing the world. Why not over-police our communities as well? You know, I just read the statistic. You're a whopping 8 times more likely to be killed by a cop than a terrorist, Dylan. I mean, considering this insane statistic, why don't you think Congress and people are kind of actively trying to combat this problem?
I think that's exactly why. And, you know, when I filed a complaint with the lieutenant after that happened with the deputy sheriff, what do you think the lieutenant said to me? Well, because of September 11th, we have to be a lot more vigilant. And yet, since, you know, 3,000 innocent people died on September 11th, and since 9/11, more American citizens have been killed by police officers than died on September 11th. That is a big problem. You know, these guys are supposed to protect and to serve, not to coerce, intimidate, and act as judge, jury, and executioner.
And Dylan, we have about 30 seconds left. Where can people go out to find more about your project and support your work?
Right now, I have a website registered that there has no website right now. So if you go to Facebook, Black and Blue Movie, look it up. I'm looking for stories. I'm looking for music. I'm looking for lots of things. So this is a very early stage in the process, and it's nice to get on and talk about it before things get really crazy.
Well, thank you so much for doing it, putting attention to such a serious issue, Dylan. I cannot wait to see the film. Thanks so much for coming on, man.
Thanks
really
for
appreciate
having
it.
Me.
Last week, an Oregon man filed a federal lawsuit against the government for a 2012 police brutality incident that left him in the need of back surgery. According to the plaintiff, Jermaine Robinson, he was biking near his home when two cops pulled him over for bike violations and then proceeded to throw him off the bike, beat, and taser him. Now, Robinson, who's an African-American, is also requesting that the city police department institutes a new policy against racial profiling. And rightfully so, because racial profiling when it comes to policing is hardly confined to Oregon. According to the National Criminal Justice Reference Service, 25% of police officers have witnessed fellow officers harassing a citizen, most likely because of their race. 52% agree that it's not unusual for a police officer to turn a blind eye to improper conduct by other officers. And 49% feel that the only way a criminal would receive punishment was to punish the individual himself. So here to discuss the institutional reasons behind these statistics, as well as his new film on police brutality called Black and Blue, I'm joined now by filmmaker Dylan Avery. Thank you so much for coming on. Dylan,
hey, Abby, good to see you, man.
So before we get into your latest work, you made the film Loose Change. It's probably the most viral online documentary ever made. I mean, how did that insane experience change you as a person and a filmmaker?
Drastically and unexpectedly. You know, it's funny that I'm here in D.C. 10 years after I was living here finalizing Loose Change, and I really had no way of anticipating how big it was going to be, how drastically it was going to change my life, how many people would reach out to me, and just how much was going to happen. So insanely, it would insanely change my life.
You know, really briefly, what do you think about kind of the movement being hijacked by kind of this everything's a conspiracy and everything's a false flag now?
You know, that's one of the reasons I had to walk away. In about 2006 is when it started. You know, you had the whole no planes at the World Trade Center nonsense and all that. So really, it really kind of came to a head 2006, 2007, and it was over the following couple years where I realized I just, you know, you say that you're for 9/11 truth, and you could mean that you're for a new investigation into the attacks, but then they'll think, you know, whoever you're talking to, like, oh, you think that no planes
so
at the
Sandy
World
Trade Center. So Sandy Hook didn't happen, right?
Yeah, like, so Sandy Hook didn't happen, and I mean, like, everything's a false flag, you know, everything is a government cover-up. I mean, 24 hours in before we even have any information, it's automatically being declared as one thing or another. So it's a dangerous situation we find ourselves in.
It is, Dylan. I think we're on the same page in a lot of ways. And I think what people were most upset about, including me, is that you, this political, amazing filmmaker, took such a long break from making political commentary. But you're back, baby. You're back. You're making the film about police brutality. What initially made you want to tackle this huge subject?
Well, you know, I'd been somewhat following the issue for a long time. You know, when Oscar Grant happened, I was up at a lot of the protests up in Oakland. But it didn't really start to seem like something that I should pursue or tackle until I moved to Los Angeles. You know, coming from upstate New York, my experiences with the police had generally been pretty positive. And even traveling across the country, you know, there were a couple times where I possibly could have been in trouble and I wasn't. So it was quite a shock to me to move to Los Angeles and, you know, one night I'm walking my dog past midnight and before I know it, I'm being interrogated by a Los Angeles deputy sheriff because I don't have my ID. And I'm like, dude, my house is right there. Like, I can literally walk and get my ID. He's like, no, I'll get into the back of my car and we're going to get to the bottom of this. So that was a real eye-opener for me. And if it wasn't for the fact that I had my dog with me, I probably would have gotten a little bit more mouthy with him. But I've seen what cops do to dogs.
Right.
And I'm sitting in the back of my cop car and I'm seeing this cop like walk up to my dog and I'm just like, oh, please just don't let anything. And that was a real eye-opener to me because it went from, we no longer see a cop car and feel protected. We feel intimidated. We feel scared. We wonder, you know, am I going to be the next Oscar Grant? Am I going to be the next whoever? You know, choose your example. And that's the thing, is there are so many examples now of injustice and police brutality. And it's not just beatings, you know, it's not just shootings, it's botched investigations, it's money doing all the talking when someone's innocent son is killed by his best friend, things like that. Like, it's across the board. The whole justice system right now is backwards.
So you're seeing a lot of these systemic kind of institutionalized things as your investigation's unfolding. You've been talking to victims, victims' families across the country, Dylan. Another aspect of police brutality is the war machine stockpiling local and state police forces. I mean, according to the Pentagon's own data, since 2006, precincts across the U.S. have been given 432 MRAP machines. I mean, these things are like giant tanks, 533 aircrafts, over 94,000 machine guns, 435 other armored vehicles, whatever that means. I mean, how much do you think the militarization of police has to do with the increased levels of force that we're seeing?
Very much so. They're intrinsically tied. I mean, Fargo, North Dakota has a tank now. And I mean, when I think terrorist attacks, I don't think Fargo, North Dakota. You know, you've got these guys, they're overseas, they're in Afghanistan, they're Iraq, they're in legitimate war zones, and then they come back to America, and then they become police officers. So they spend all day, every day, being shot at, being threatened, fearing for their life, etc. And then they come home, and then they're given a badge and a gun, and they're told to go out into the streets, and they bring that mentality back home with them. So I think that the militarization of the police is a big facet of why we find ourselves faced with the problem that we have now.
Yeah. You know, a few months ago, I spoke to Ray Lewis. He was a police commissioner for Philadelphia, and he became an Occupy activist, actually. And he said that police agencies actually vet candidates who are the most sociopathic and lacking empathy. I mean, it's just amazing to hear this coming from someone as high up as he was. I mean, do you think that there's a systematic effort here from the top down to institutionalize this kind of brutality?
Yeah, absolutely. And there was that headline that was going around a while ago where, you know, someone tried to become a cop and they told them, oh, I'm sorry, your IQ is too high. You know, and that's the thing, is like, what kind of person wants to both follow orders and then enforce the orders that they're given onto other people? Like, it takes a certain, like, I don't see you or me becoming a police officer. I don't see any of these cops getting off the job and going home and playing their guitar. You know, which isn't to say that all cops are bad, which is right. really the kind of paradigm that I'm trying to make sure I make clear from the start with this is not an anti-police film. It is an anti-police brutality and injustice film. So if you were a good cop, you got nothing to worry about. But if you're a bad cop, then you might wind up in my film.
Why do you think this is, Dylan? Because I feel like compared to other, especially European countries, I guess, America just has such what's become an epidemic now of Absolutely. This brutality. What is it about this country?
I don't know. I think that the past decade, a lot of things in this country have changed. I mean, before September 11th, there was no TSA. There was no department.
Last week, an Oregon man filed a federal lawsuit against the government for a 2012 police brutality incident that left him in the need of back surgery. According to the plaintiff, Jermaine Robinson, he was biking near his home when two cops pulled him over for bike violations and then proceeded to throw him off the bike, beat, and taser him. Now, Robinson, who's an African American, is also requesting that the city police department institutes a new policy against racial profiling. And rightfully so, because racial profiling when it comes to policing is hardly confined to Oregon. According to the National Criminal Justice Reference Service, 25% of police officers have witnessed fellow officers harassing a citizen, most likely because of their race. 52% agree that it's not unusual for police officer to turn a blind eye to improper conduct by other officers. And 49% feel that the only way a criminal would receive punishment was to punish the individual himself. So here to discuss the institutional reasons behind these statistics, as well as his new film on police brutality called Black and Blue, I'm joined now by filmmaker Dylan Avery. Thank you so much for coming on, Dylan.
Hey, good to see you, man.
So before we get into your latest work, you made the film Loose Change. It's probably the most viral online documentary ever made. I mean, how did that insane experience change you as a person and a filmmaker?
Drastically and unexpectedly. You know, it's funny that I'm here in D.C. 10 years after I was living here finalizing Loose Change, and I really had no way of anticipating how big it was going to be, how drastically it was going to change my life, how many people would reach out to me, and just how much was going to happen. So insanely, it would insanely change my life.
You know, really briefly, what do you think about kind of the movement being hijacked by kind of this everything is a conspiracy and everything's a false flag now?
You know, that's one of the reasons I had to walk away. In about 2006 is when it started. You know, you had the whole no planes at the World Trade Center nonsense and all that. So really, it really kind of came to a head 2006, 2007, and it was over the following couple of years where I realized you say that you're for 9/11 truth, and you could mean that you're for a new investigation into the attacks, but then they'll think, you know, whoever you're talking to, like, oh, you think that no planes
at the World Trade Center. So Sandy Hook didn't happen, right?
Sandy Hook didn't happen, and I mean, like, everything's a false flag, you know, right. Everything is a government cover-up. I mean, 24 hours in, before we even have any information, it's automatically being declared as one thing or another. So it's a dangerous situation we find ourselves in.
It is, Dylan. I think we're on the same page in a lot of ways. And I think what people were most upset about, including me, is that you, this political, amazing filmmaker, took such a long break from making political commentary. But you're back, baby. You're back. You're making the film about police brutality.
You know, everything is a government cover-up. I mean, 24 hours in, before we even have any information, it's automatically being declared as one thing or another. So it's a dangerous situation we find ourselves in.
It is, Dylan. I think we're on the same page in a lot of ways. And I think what people were most upset about, including me, is that you, this political, amazing filmmaker, took such a long break from making political commentary. But you're back, baby. You're back. You're making the film about police brutality. What initially made you want to tackle this huge subject?
Well, you know, I'd been somewhat following the issue for a long time. You know, when Oscar Grant happened, I was up at a lot of the protests up in Oakland. But it didn't really start to seem like something that I should pursue or tackle until I moved to Los Angeles. You know, coming from upstate New York, my experiences with the police had generally been pretty positive. And even traveling across the country, you know, there were a couple times where I possibly could have been in trouble and I wasn't. So it was quite a shock to me to move to Los Angeles and, you know, one night I'm walking my dog past midnight, and before I know it, I'm being interrogated by a Los Angeles deputy sheriff because I don't have my ID. And I'm like, dude, my house is right there. Like, I can literally walk and get my ID. He's like, no, I'll get into the back of my car and we're going to get to the bottom of this. So that was a real eye-opener for me. And if it wasn't for the fact that I had my dog with me, I probably would have gotten a little bit more mouthy with him. But I've seen what cops do to dogs.
Right.
And I'm sitting in the back of my cop car and I'm seeing this cop like walk up to my dog and I'm just like, oh, please just don't let anything. And that was a real eye-opener to me because it went from, we no longer see a cop car and feel protected. We feel intimidated. We feel scared. We wonder, you know, am I going to be the next Oscar Grant? Am I going to be the next whoever? You know, choose your example. And that's the thing, is there are so many examples now of injustice and police brutality. And it's not just beatings, you know, it's not just shootings, it's botched investigations, it's money doing all the talking when someone's innocent son is killed by his best friend, things like that. Like, it's across the board. The whole justice system right now is backwards.
So you're seeing a lot of these systemic kind of institutionalized things as your investigation's unfolding. You've been talking to victims, victims' families across the country. Dylan, another aspect of police brutality is the war machine stockpiling local and state police forces. I mean, according to the Pentagon's own data, since 2006, precincts across the U.S. have been given 432 MRAP machines. I mean, these things are like giant tanks, 533 aircrafts, over 94,000 machine guns, 435 other armored vehicles, whatever that means. I mean, how much do you think the militarization of police has to do with the increased levels of force that we're seeing?
Very much so. They're intrinsically tied. I mean, Fargo, North Dakota has a tank now. And I mean, when I think terrorist attacks, I don't think Fargo, North Dakota. You know, you've got these guys, they're overseas, they're in Afghanistan, they're Iraq, they're in legitimate war zones, and then they come back to America, and then they become police.
And support your work.
Right now, I have a website registered that there has no website right now. So if you go to Facebook, Black and Blue Movie, look it up. I'm looking for stories, I'm looking for music, I'm looking for lots of things. So this is a very early stage in the process, and it's nice to get on and talk about it before things get really crazy.
Well, thank you so much for doing it, putting attention to such a serious issue, Dylan. I cannot wait to see the film. Thanks so much for coming on, man.
Thanks
really
for
appreciate
having
it.
Me.
Last week, an Oregon man filed a federal lawsuit against the government for a 2012 police brutality incident that left him in the need of back surgery. According to the plaintiff, Jermaine Robinson, he was biking near his home when two cops pulled him over for bike violations and then proceeded to throw him off the bike, beat, and taser him. Now, Robinson, who's an African-American, is also requesting that the city police department institutes a new policy against racial profiling. And rightfully so, because racial profiling when it comes to policing is hardly confined to Oregon. According to the National Criminal Justice Reference Service, 25% of police officers have witnessed fellow officers harassing a citizen, most likely because of their race. 52% agree that it's not unusual for a police officer to turn a blind eye to improper conduct by other officers. And 49% feel that the only way a criminal would receive punishment was to punish the individual himself. So here to discuss the institutional reasons behind these statistics, as well as his new film on police brutality called Black and Blue, I'm joined now by filmmaker Dylan Avery. Thank you so much for coming on, Dylan.
Hey, Abby,
good to see you, man.
You.
So before we get into your latest work, you made the film Loose Change. It's probably the most viral online documentary ever made. I mean, how did that insane experience change you as a person and a filmmaker?
Drastically and unexpectedly. You know, it's funny that I'm here in D.C. 10 years after I was living here finalizing Loose Change, and I really had no way of anticipating how big it was going to be, how drastically it was going to change my life, how many people would reach out to me, and just how much was going to happen. So insanely, it would insanely change my life.
You know, really briefly, what do you think about kind of the movement being hijacked by kind of this everything's a conspiracy and everything's a false flag now?
You know, that's one of the reasons I had to walk away. In about 2006 is when it started. You know, you had the whole no planes at the World Trade Center nonsense and all that. So really, it really kind of came to a head 2006, 2007, and it was over the following couple years where I realized I just, you know, you say that you're for 9/11 truth, and you could mean that you're for a new investigation into the attacks, but then they'll think, you know, whoever you're talking to, like, oh, you think that no planes
at the World Trade Center. So Sandy Hook didn't happen, right?
Sandy Hook didn't happen, and I mean, like, everything's a false flag.
I spoke to Ray Lewis. He was a police commissioner for Philadelphia, and he became an Occupy activist, actually, and he said that police agencies actually vet candidates who are the most sociopathic and lacking empathy. I mean, it's just amazing to hear this coming from someone as high up as he was. I mean, do you think that there's a systematic effort here from the top down to institutionalize this kind of brutality?
Yeah, absolutely. And there was that headline that was going around a while ago where, someone tried to become a cop and they told them, oh, I'm sorry, your IQ is too high. You know, and that's the thing is, like, what kind of person wants to both follow orders and then enforce the orders that they're given onto other people? Like, it takes a certain, like, I don't see you or me becoming a police officer. I don't see any of these cops getting off the job and going home and playing their guitar. Which isn't to say that all cops are bad, which is really the kind of paradigm that I'm trying to make sure I make clear from the start with this, is this is not an anti-police film. It is an anti-police brutality and injustice film. So if you were a good cop, you got nothing to worry about. But if you're a bad cop, then you might wind up in my film.
Why do you think this is, Dylan? Because I feel like compared to other, especially European countries, I guess, America just has such what's become an epidemic now of Absolutely. This brutality. What is it about this country?
I don't know. I think that the past decade, a lot of things in this country have changed. I mean, before September 11th, there was no TSA. There was no Department of Homeland Security. Border Patrol was handled by Border Patrol. Now it's handled by the Department of Homeland Security. You have seen an increase of a war machine that was already there and already existed. I mean, Smedley Butler was, very clear on that. Dwight Eisenhower, warned us about the military-industrial complex, except now that has seeped into our local police departments. So it's really hard to try and point to one particular thing and say this is the cause, and I don't even know if I'm going to be able to do it in the film, but, we have a serious situation on our hands, and I think that there's a lot of facets that play into it.
Yeah, you're right. I think it really is the military mind, children of the empire, having kind of this moral authority to, we're policing the world. Why not over-police our communities as well? I just read the statistic. You're a whopping 8 times more likely to be killed by a cop than a terrorist, Dylan. I mean, considering this insane statistic, why don't you think Congress and people are kind of actively trying to combat this problem?
I think that's exactly why. And, when I filed a complaint with the lieutenant after that happened with the deputy sheriff, what do you think the lieutenant said to me? Well, because of September 11th, we have to be a lot more vigilant. And yet, since 3,000 innocent people died on September 11th, and since 9/11, more American citizens have been killed by police officers than died on September 11th. That is a big problem. These guys are supposed to protect and to serve, not to coerce, intimidate, and act as judge, jury, and executioner.
And Dylan, we have about 30 seconds left. Where can people go out to find more about your project? What initially made you want to tackle this huge subject?
Well, I had been I'd been somewhat following the issue for a long time. When Oscar Grant happened, I was up at a lot of the protests up in Oakland. But it didn't really start to seem like something that I should pursue or tackle until I moved to Los Angeles. Coming from upstate New York, my experiences with the police had generally been pretty positive. And even traveling across the country, there were a couple times where I possibly could have been in trouble and I wasn't. So it was quite a shock to me to move to Los Angeles and, one night I'm walking my dog past midnight and before I know it, I'm being interrogated by a Los Angeles deputy sheriff because I don't have my ID. And I'm like, dude, my house is right there. Like, I can literally walk and get my ID. He's like, no, I'll get into the back of my car and we're gonna get to the bottom of this. So that was a real eye-opener for me. And if it wasn't for the fact that I had my dog with me, I probably would have gotten a little bit more mouthy with him. But I've seen what cops do to dogs.
Right.
And I'm sitting in the back of my cop car, and I'm seeing this cop, walk up to my dog, and I'm just like, oh, please just don't let anything. And that was a real eye-opener to me because it went from, we no longer see a cop car and feel protected. We feel intimidated. We feel scared. We wonder, am I going to be the next Oscar Grant? Am I going to be the next whoever? Choose your example. And that's the thing, is there are so many examples now of injustice and police brutality. And it's not just beatings, it's not just shootings. It's botched investigations. It's money doing all the talking when someone's innocent son is killed by his best friend. Things like that. Like, it's across the board. The whole justice system right now is backwards.
So you're seeing a lot of these systemic kind of institutionalized things as your investigation's unfolding. You've been talking to victims, victims' families across the country. Dylan, another aspect of police brutality is the war machine stockpiling local and state police forces. I mean, according to the Pentagon's own data, since 2006, precincts across the U.S. have been given 432 MRAP machines. I mean, these things are like giant tanks, 533 aircrafts, over 94,000 machine guns, 435 other armored vehicles, whatever that means. I mean, how much do you think the militarization of police has to do with the increased levels of force that we're seeing?
Very much so. They're intrinsically tied. I mean, Fargo, North Dakota has a tank now. And I mean, when I think terrorist attacks, I don't think Fargo, North Dakota. You know, you've got these guys, they're overseas, they're in Afghanistan, they're Iraq, they're in legitimate war zones, and then they come back to America, and then they become police officers. So they spend all day, every day, being shot at, being threatened, fearing for their life, etc. And then they come home, and then they're given a badge and a gun, and they're told to go out into the streets, and they bring that mentality back home with them. So I think that the militarization of the police is a big facet of why we find ourselves faced with the problem that we have now.
Yeah. You know, a few months ago,